Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 to 22, from the ESV. I shall now read. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me." Saying to them, "Go into the..." If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, "The Lord needs them," and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." And Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who sold and bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. He said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you make it a den of robbers." And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. And they said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" And Jesus said to them, "Yes, have you never read, 'Out of the mouth of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise'?" And leaving them, he went out of the city to Bethany and lodged there. In the morning, as he was returning to the city, he became hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the wayside, he went to it and found nothing on it but only leaves. And he said to it, "May no fruit ever come from you again." And the fig tree withered at once. When the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, "How did the fig tree wither at once?" And Jesus answered them, "Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, 'Be taken up and thrown into the sea,' it will happen. And whatever you ask in prayer, you will receive if you have faith."
Well, good morning, everyone, and happy Palm Sunday to everyone. We are reaching, which means we are reaching the last stage of our observance of Lent and the beginning of the week, Holy Week, leading to Good Friday and Easter. I'm excited about this. And I'm excited to hear our preacher on the subject of Palm Sunday. Our speaker today is a good friend of mine, a good friend of many of the pastors of this church, Pastor Daniel Tan from Mount Hermon Bible Presbyterian Church. He's also the moderator of the Bible Presbyterian Church in Singapore. So be nice to him because he is the moderator of the presbytery of which we are a part. As I invite Pastor Daniel to come up now to pray for him, let me just tell you something personal about him. I've always enjoyed meeting with him. He's always friendly and nice. And I just want to say that when he's here, He's not only our guest preacher, but he's also a hostage, because Pastor LB is preaching at Hermon this morning. And if Hermon doesn't allow him to come back, we are holding Pastor Daniel as our hostage in exchange. I think we have a better deal because Pastor Lewin is coming at a 3 and 5 as well. So let me pray for Pastor Daniel as he speaks to us. Lord, we want to thank you that in Christian unity we can have fellowship with each other from different congregations. We thank you that Pastor Daniel is able to speak to us this morning, and we ask for your Holy Spirit to work in him, through him, to us with your word. We want to hear from you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Ziming, for the introduction and for the prayer. May I invite all of us to keep our Bibles open, if you do have it physically or on your handphones, to keep it on, to Matthew chapter 21, verse 1 to 22. So once again, a blessed Palm Sunday to all. I bring you greetings from Mount Hermon. We are all the way in the northwest of Singapore, Choa Chu Kang. May I also take this opportunity, since I'm here, to thank Zion Bishan for your gracious and generous support during our fundraising for our development fund over the past 2 years. Now, in a very tangible way, we in Hermon have experienced the blessings of being in a presbytery. So thank you very much, members of Zion Bishan. Let's begin our time in prayer. Father, we pray that you will come and open your truth to us so that we may hear, observe, believe, and live it out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, what is an object lesson? The dictionary says, an object lesson is something that served as the practical example of a principle or an abstract idea. So it is something tangible which we can relate to and that which helps us to understand something much deeper. Now, in the Bible, we could see this come across as parables. In today's text, I'd submit that there are three scenes that Jesus is part of, and I'd like to suggest that they are object lessons or enacted parables for us. Now, each setting, whether it is cruising into Jerusalem, clearing the temple, or cursing the fig tree, Jesus tells us something about who he is, who we are, and how we should appropriately respond. Thus, my sharing is titled today, Who is This? And it is taken from Matthew chapter 21, verse 10. Now, this is the question that the whole of Jerusalem is asking. Who is this? Who is this Jesus of Nazareth? Jerusalem, we know, it's a center of religious, political, and social life of the nation of Israel. Now, its significance to the Jews has not changed even in the 21st century. So Matthew writes in verse 10 that when Jesus entered the Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, meaning that there was great anxiety. Now, this brings us back to a similar phrase right at the beginning of Matthew. Matthew chapter 2, verse 3 says that when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Now, this is the earth-shattering impact that Jesus, when his presence comes before men. Right? As the King of Kings comes before his creation, well, all of us, mankind, has to decide, will I submit in reverence or will I reject in disobedience? A decision for or against Jesus Christ is life-altering. It impacts us in every way. Today, the question is posed to us afresh. Who is this Jesus to you and to me? Let's begin. Our humble King. Now, one feature of Matthew is his fulfillment quotations of the Old Testament. Now, since he's written or writing this gospel for a mainly Jewish audience, Matthew throughout has been attempting to show that Jesus fulfills the prophecy of the Messiah. And so we see 10 quotations here in Matthew, and this section we see the ninth quotation in Matthew chapter 21, verse 5. It is from Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Now, the context of Zechariah is about salvation of Israel by a righteous king. And so Matthew is telling his first audience, Jesus is fulfilling literally this prophecy in riding a colt into Jerusalem. Jesus is the messianic king of Israel. And so we see in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 10, Scripture says that the king shall speak peace to the nation. So Jesus is a humble, a meek king who comes to bring peace, peace between God and men. Thus, his choice of a colt is significant, a beast of burden and not a war horse. So it is right that they shout, Hosanna to the Son of David. Praise the Lord for this long-awaited divine king, the one who will sit on David's throne forever and ever. Today, I submit, we need firstly to acknowledge that Jesus is king. That means that he is Lord and he is master. And what does that mean then? Correspondingly, it means that for us, we are his servants, and thus obedience is required of us. We are not then to be the master of our own destiny, the captain of our own ship. So here now, 2021, who is chartering the course of my life? Is it King Jesus or is it Prince Daniel? Well, the disciples show us what obedience looked like. Verse 6 tells us that the disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. So this morning, are we like the disciples? Do we follow Jesus as he has directed us so clearly from Scripture? I'm sure we all know the phrase, either Jesus is Lord of all, if not, he is not Lord at all. So this morning, where does Jesus rank against our careers, our hobbies, Netflix, Disney Plus, HIIT? Consider the example of the owner of the donkey and the coach. Would we say that Jesus is Lord over all our possessions? And when the Lord has need of them, we will surrender it to Jesus? Who is Jesus to us this morning? May he truly be king. May he truly have first right over all that we are and all that we have. Now we see that Jesus is also our humble servant king. Now in a few days, Jesus will fulfill the angel's prophecy to Joseph that we find right at the beginning of Matthew, that Jesus will live out his name, for by his death on the cross, Jesus will save his people from their sin. Now Jesus, our humble king, came not to be served, but to serve. So a familiar hymn, I hope, for all of us is, Brother, let me be your servant. Let me be as Christ to you. We are pilgrims on a journey. We are sisters on the road. We are here to help each other. Walk the mile and bear the load. Now, last year, I read with thanksgiving to God for what members of Zion Bishan did for the community, for foreign workers, and the rough sleepers. Now, your expenditure of resources, of time, of effort to be a blessing to the community and to one another is a great testimony. Thank you. Thank you, Zion Bishan, for serving Jesus like the donkey's owner. Now, in Jesus' fulfillment of the Zechariah passage, we see that God is in control of all of history. So we see that in the distant past, God had already said that such a king would come. Jesus in first century Israel was able to fulfill it. Now God oversaw everything. He made every preparation, and then he graciously gathered the disciples and included them in his plan. What a sovereign king we worship. Today, Scripture reminds us that God's plans are so wise and so perfect. God knows everything from time past to time future. since God's plans will be fulfilled in His perfect timing, then the reminder for all of us today is that we can continue to trust God's leading day by day. Let's trust God that it is blessed to be meek, to hunger after righteousness, to be merciful, to be a peacemaker. Let's trust God that we seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness, God will definitely continue to take care of us. Friends, to you this morning, who is this Jesus who rode a coach into Jerusalem? Now, the ending of chapter 20, which is the previous chapter, we are looking at chapter 21 today. It's about Jesus healing the two blind men. There, they address Jesus as Son of David. As we look at chapter 21 today, Matthew's gospel is specifically opening our eyes to show us this Jesus who is the Son of David. And so the link between these passages, chapter 20, the end of 20 and 21, is with the title Son of David, and I put there the three times that it is mentioned. Now, significantly, it is uttered not from those we would have naturally expected it from. See, in chapter 20, verse 30, the crowd who was sighted, the crowd who heard and saw and seen his miracles, they could not see who Jesus was, but the two blind men could. In 21, verse 9, it is the crowd who followed Jesus from Bethpage, not the residents of Jerusalem, the so-called city folk, the elite, who acknowledged Jesus as the Son of David. Finally, in 20, verse 15, it is not the chief priests and the scribes, but instead the children who shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David." So, we see those who should have known better have hardened their hearts and thus cannot see. But the Lord has given grace to the poor in spirit, to the pure in heart, for they see Jesus for who He is, the royal and divine Son of David. Now, for those of us who see Jesus as the Messianic King, let us be grateful. Let us be thankful. If today you have not seen Jesus as such, may I ask you to sincerely request Jesus request God to allow you to see Jesus. Matthew has shown us that you do not need physical sight. You can be weak. You can be insignificant. You can also not be the elite at all in society. But through the eyes of faith, you will be able to see. Let's be encouraged that anyone can receive God's grace to believe that Jesus is the Messianic King. Now, for those of us who have loved ones, who have yet to know Jesus as the Son of David, would we bring their names before God right now? Let us lift their names up to the Lord in prayer. Let me give us a pause here. Just in a prayer, bring your friends, your neighbors, your colleagues, your children, your family, those who have yet to know the Lord, bring them to the Lord in prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Amen. Now, in this second scene, Jesus entered the temple and drives out all the money changers and those who sold the pigeons for the sacrifice. Now, the part of the temple in which he was doing this cleansing is the outer courts, known as the court of the Gentiles. So according to Jewish tradition, Caiaphas, the high priest at that time, had moved the trade of the sacrificial animal from the Kidron Valley to the temple itself. The Kidron Valley is at the bottom and the temple at the top. Now, it seems that this was for the convenience of the worshippers, and especially to enable the animals to become not become unacceptable for the sacrifice as they're carried from the valley upwards to the temple. Now, to the Jews, it did not matter because they could go into the courts of men and the courts of the woman, which is separated from the courts of the Gentiles, and because they were further in the temple area. But by having the merchants in the courts of the Gentiles, this prevented the Gentiles from worshipping and praying to Yahweh. So Jesus displayed righteous anger to show them that the temple needs to be restored to God's ordained purpose. My house shall be called a house of prayer. And now here, Jesus is quoting from Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7. And the context here is that in verse 6, foreigners and eunuchs have equal access to worship of God. So we see that Jesus here is our inclusive King. Now, in Christ, we know there is neither Greek nor Jew, there is neither male nor female, there is neither slave nor free. All are one in Christ. And to bring this point further, Matthew records for us in verse 14, the blind and the lame came to him in the temple and he healed them. Now, from Leviticus chapter 21, we know that no one who is blind or lame can be a priest. So Leviticus chapter 21, verse 18 says, for no one has the blemish shall draw near a man blind or lame, or one who has the mutilated face or a limb too long. Now, the blind, the lame, the children, the Gentiles, the slave, even women were of a lower class in society. And there were restrictions placed on them. They were prevented then from direct access to the place of worship. Jesus condemns the Jewish leadership for preventing the Gentiles from worshiping, and by his act of healing, gave access to the blind and the lame. So Jesus is our inclusive King. Are we today in Singapore churches an inclusive society, people? Do we welcome people not like us to worship God together? Now, Hermon was introduced to the work of OM that does evangelism among street ladies in Geylang a few years ago. Now, even as we were being introduced to the ministry, and even as we, a few of us, went together with OM to walk the streets of Geylang, I'm not sure how comfortable we in Hermon would be if they were to join our faith community. Now, many churches, I'm sure, including Zion Bishan, minister to residents of the Helping Hand. Now, remember when I was growing up in the mid-1980s, my pastor in Hermon then had to preach a few sermons to help members understand biblically the need to be inclusive. I'm not sure about Zion Bishan, but in Hermon, right, we have received some feedback. We are quite inward-looking. We tend to only fellowship with our existing friends right after service. Now, with the restriction of 8 per group, right, that's even worse. The clique becomes more entrenched. Now, one reason we've discovered is that people only fellowship with their existing friends because, see, Sunday after service or before service is the only time of the week that they connect. Right? So I've known this person for the last 20 years. I want to connect with him on Sunday. So now, we are attempting to encourage members to be in our small groups, right? To be in our fellowship groups. And so all these groups to meet during the week. Now that we've been able to meet our existing friends during the week, this then, we pray, gives us the space to develop new friendships with others after Sunday service. Now, one of my lay leaders now, so he takes the list of all who have registered, right? And then what he tries to do is that he will try and see whether he can call one or two of them and make an appointment for fellowship with either with these people either before or after service, and every week with someone different. I'm sure for Zion Bishan, you all are streets ahead of us at Hermon, and in this respect. And so I'm sure we can all be encouraged by your inclusiveness. In verse 13, not only were they preventing the Gentiles from worshiping, Jesus said they are making it a den of robbers. Now, this, I submit, does not refer so much to cheating customers who are purchasing sacrifices, but I'm sure they were capable of doing it. But it's more to do with the hypocrisy of their lives. See, the reason is that this phrase, den of robbers, is taken from Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 11. And in the context of Jeremiah chapter 7, is that the Jews were living in blatant sin in their lives outside the temple. Yet they come in, and then they so-called hid in the temple and appeared pious and God-fearing in the temple. So God, through Jeremiah, exposes the hypocrisy of the Israelites. And I just read from Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 9 to 10. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, make offering to Baal, and go after other gods that you have not known, and then come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered, only to go on doing all these abominations? So with regard to Jesus' critique of them being a den of robbers, may I submit that Jesus is our incisive King. Now, Jesus is razor sharp in his perception and his insights about our true behavior. Now, as with Jeremiah and the Israelites, nothing we do escapes King Jesus' attention. Are we as inconsistent as the Israelites of Jeremiah's time? Are we one thing in church and a completely different person outside? Well, let's listen to the warning that Jeremiah gave to his first audience. And now, because you have done all these things, declares the Lord, and when I spoke to you persistently, you did not listen, and when I called you, you did not answer, therefore I will do to the house that is called by my name and in which you trust, and to the place that I've gave to you and your fathers, as I did to Shiloh. I will cast you out of my sight, and I will cast out all your kinsmen and all the offspring of Ephraim. As for you, talking to Jeremiah, do not pray for these people or lift up a cry or prayer for them. Do not intercede with me, for I will not hear you. No wonder that the chief priests and the scribes, they were indignant. They were furious with Jesus for him being inclusive and incisive. And it seems, you know, goes in threes, to raise their blood pressure further. Jesus quotes Psalm 8, verse 2. And it says, out of the mouth of infants and nursing babes, right, you have prepared praise. And then he applies that to himself. See, Psalm 8 is about worshiping our Creator God who made the heavens and the earth, a God who made man and who cares for man and all of creation. So again, Jesus, by applying it to himself, is telling them in Scripture, he is God. He is the divine Son of God and Son of David. So friends, to you this morning, who is this Jesus who cleansed the temple and healed the blind and the lame? We now come to our final enacted parable. Now, if you want a more detailed chronological flow of this cursing of the fig tree, do turn to Mark chapter 11. Now, Matthew condenses it so that he's intending to make a theological point. Now, in order to appreciate this, we need to understand agriculture. And so, I don't know anything about agriculture. So, based on what I've researched, the Passover is in April. And then that means that winter has passed. So, leaves on a fig tree normally appear after the first fruit has come. So a tree with lots of leaves would mean that there already be some fruits. Right? These fruits are the small edible fruit buds that appear before the leaves come. And then the main fruit will usually come later. But it was known to farmers and all who understand agriculture that if leaves come but the early first fruits do not appear first, then for that season, that particular tree will not bear any fruit subsequently. Why did Jesus target a fig tree? Well, from Old Testament passages, we know that a fig tree symbolizes the nation of Israel, and barren fig trees represent the disobedience and the corruption in the nation. So remember, John the Baptist said to the Pharisees and to the Sadducees, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Jesus is pronouncing that the nation of Israel has not borne any fruit in keeping with repentance, for they have rejected the Messiah. And so as the fig tree is cursed, so will the disobedient nation of Israel be condemned. Jesus came as redeeming king, but he will come again as judge. If we reject him as savior and king, the warning of the fig tree will apply. And how do we know that we have accepted Jesus as Messiah? Well, our fruit will show. There will be visible evidence in our lives. So believing in Jesus is not a life insurance which we obtain and only cash in at our deathbed. Believing in Jesus is accepting him as King, living each day according to his kingdom principles. Our obedience, our growing in more and more into his likeness is the fruit, the evidence of sonship. Now, in our second point, we realize that Jesus is incisive. Right? God knows our heart, and so we cannot fool God by just going with the flow of doing and saying so-called Christian things. God knows whether we are genuine, even if we are able to fool our fellow men. And if at this point, all of us say, well, die lah, you know, to be a Christian, so hard, impossible. I submit that that's precisely where we must start. Anything above that will be prideful self-reliance. Jesus gives the answer to the power that is available for the disciples, the power to live for Jesus, the power to be a Christian. He says, if you have faith and do not doubt, you can do what I just did to the fig tree and even move mountains. Now, with such power available by Jesus for us, we better understand it correctly, right? So that we truly can be empowered. So firstly, to not have doubts, what does that mean? Well, it means not to have a divided mind. It means not to trust God only partway and at the same time center on self. It means to be able to trust God fully by being obedient to his teaching and leading. Secondly, the phrase moving mountains, well, it's not to be taken literally. Even during Jesus' time, it was an accepted expression of doing the impossible. And finally, to leave us in no doubt that dynamic faith to do the impossible is about God's will and not ours. Jesus says in verse 22, and everything, whatever you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. And so because Jesus talks about prayer, we have to ask ourselves, what did Jesus teach about prayer? And so we know already from Matthew chapter 5, verse 9 to 13, the prayer that I'm sure all of us here as believers have memorized. And it says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So the immediate withering of the fig tree displays the power of Jesus. And Jesus is saying to the disciples and to us, such power to live a glorious life for Jesus and his kingdom is available to us in prayer. Friends, to you this morning, who is this Jesus who has the power to wither a fig tree? May I close our time with the testimony of Pastor Edward Peronet. Now, he lived in the 18th century England. Now, his ministry, I understand, was tough, for it was written that when he visited some towns, he was thrown down from the horses that he was riding on, and he was rolled in the mud, and he had stones hurled at him. Yet he persevered. Even for a time, he served as a missionary to India. He died in 1792 and is now buried in Canterbury Cathedral in Kent, England. Now, Edward persevered in ministry because he knew who Jesus was. His testimony is found in the lyrics of the hymn that he wrote. It is titled, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. See, to Edward, Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That in Christ, it is possible for every kindred and every tribe on this earth to come to worship him. And that indeed, Jesus' name is all powerful, for all authority has been given to him. So friends, who is this Jesus to you today? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for preserving your word for us today. We ask that as we commemorate Palm Sunday, we behold Jesus for who he is, and thereby align our lives accordingly. Amen.